Hello, and welcome to this pre-concert talk on the dance music of Dowland and Holborne. I'm really pleased to be able to talk to you about this as part of this year's Boston Early Music Festival, albeit from across the Atlantic. I'm in York in the United Kingdom. This music's been part of my professional life as a viol player and also as a musicologist, and I'm really pleased to be able to share some thoughts about the music that will hopefully give you a context in which to listen to it. The music comes from two very important publications that came right at the end of the 16th century and the beginning of the 17th. In 1599, Anthony Holborne's Pavans, Galliards and Almains were published. And then just after the death of Queen Elizabeth and the accession of James I, Dowland brought out his Lachrimae, Seven Passionate Pavans and other dances. Dancing was a really important part of everyone's upbringing if they were aspiring towards higher social status in Elizabethan England and elsewhere in Europe. Dancing was a brilliant form of aerobic exercise. It could be quite energetic, and Queen Elizabeth I, even in her mature years, was said to dance five or six galliards in the morning. It was also very good for brain training because it required you to remember quite complex dance patterns, both for your feet and sometimes for your hands, and in the galliards, some quite athletic movements for the men. It was a way of learning social decorum, of meeting the opposite sex, of being able to converse with them and even hold hands with them in a way that might not be possible in other social circumstances. You even got so close to your partner that you could smell whether his or her breath was fresh, as one of the treatises told you to make sure before you got too far involved with them. And of course, the puritanical writers of the time criticised all this close contact activity in dancing as being quite dangerous for young people to be involved with. What I'm interested here is that Dowland and Holborne both took the dance forms of their time and began to transform them into something rather deeper than functional dance music, rather like Haydn and Mozart did with the minuet in their classical symphonies and chamber music. And it's quite interesting to see how Dowland in particular exploits the shape of the pavan and the galliard to write music of quite profound meaning, though quite what that meaning is to be disputed and is open to many different interpretations. I'd like to make the main focus of this pre-concert talk the seven pavans, the Lachrimae pavans, with which Lachrimae opened their programme this evening, as did Dowland in his own publication. And I'll talk about these as well as the other dances, the perhaps rather lighter weight dances, the galliards that follow, both by Dowland and by Holborne. And in order to do this, I'm just going to find my illustrations for you. So here we have Queen Elizabeth herself and the title pages of the two publications. Dowland and Holborne had rather different career pathways. Dowland's fame was as a lute player and composer for the lute. He was highly paid, an international star, working for all sorts of people, including the King of Denmark. We don't know much about his early life, but as a young man, he was working in Paris as a musical servant to Sir Henry Cobham, the English ambassador. And it was probably in Paris that he converted to Roman Catholicism. Elizabeth, of course, was a Protestant queen, and this possibly led to some of the problems he had with seeking employment in the English court musical establishment. In 1594, a vacancy in the lutes appeared in the royal establishment, but he was looked over, and so left England and decided to go and study with Marenzio in Italy. He didn't get to Marenzio in Rome and fell in with some Roman Catholic plotters in Florence. He realised his mistake and wrote to Sir Robert Cecil, the Secretary of State, apologising greatly for having got involved with these people and saying that although he was a Roman Catholic, he was certainly no traitor. And he even quotes something that Queen Elizabeth had said to him. He said, "I was a man to serve any prince in the world, but I was an obstinate papist," which was probably why Queen Elizabeth would not appoint him. Dowland was quite successful though in the late 1590s. In 1597, he published his first book of Aeirs, which was highly successful, going through several reprints. and in 1598 found himself in Denmark working for Christian IV. He also was associated with the Earl of Essex, which was unfortunate seeing as the Earl of Essex was executed as a traitor in 1600. And maybe after the Queen Elizabeth's death, he was using Lachrimae as a way of lobbying King James I for an appointment at court. He didn't get it then. In fact, he wasn't appointed until quite late on in his career in 1612. Dowland knew Holborne. He dedicated the opening song, I Saw My Lady Weep, of his second book of songs to the most famous Anthony Holborne. And Dowland's pavan Sir Henry Umpton's funeral is very closely based on The Funerals, which Holborne published in his 1599 book. We don't know much about Holborne's background either. He may well have come from a merchant family in London. He may be the person that graduated from Cambridge in 1562 and trained as a lawyer at the Inner Temple. And he describes himself on the title page as servant to Her Most Excellent Majesty. Elsewhere, he describes himself as a gentleman usher to Queen Elizabeth, a minor courtier. And amongst the things he did was to run diplomatic missions to the Netherlands, delivering sensitive letters on behalf of Sir Robert Cecil. Lachrimae, published in 1604, the title page is quite interesting. Here we see it, seven tears figured in seven passionate pavans, with divers other pavans, galliards and almonds, brought forth for the lute, viols or violins in five parts. So the scoring is specified. It's for the lute, importantly, Dowland's own instrument, and arranged for viols or violins, the violin band, in five parts. Dowland then goes on to give himself some prestige as a Bachelor of Music and lutenist to the Royal and Magnificent Christian. And then he puts a little Latin tag, aut furit aut lacrimat, quem non fortuna beavit. He either rages or weeps, whom fortune has not blessed. He dedicates the volume to Queen Anne of Denmark. Anne was Christian IV's sister, but more importantly, she was the wife of James VI of Scotland, who'd become James I of England. And clearly, on a visit to England, he'd met with the Queen. He says he had access to Your Highness at Winchester, and then goes on to describe these pieces that he's dedicated to her, asking her for her protection over them in the usual very sycophantic terms. And he describes them as showers of harmony. And he points out that while tears are unfit guests in these joyful times, yet no doubt pleasant are the tears which music weeps. Neither are tears shed always in sorrow, but sometimes in joy and gladness. And that hints at some sense of these seven tears representing different aspects of weeping, which gives us an idea of the organisation of them. The table of the songs contained in this book gives us the contents. We have the seven Lachrimae pavans, then three more pavans, one which Dowland names after himself, Semper Dowland, Semper Dolens, always Dowland, always weeping. And that perhaps gives us a hint as to how he would pronounce his name, perhaps Dowland rather than Dowland, to go with Dolens. Two more pavans, and then nine galliards, starting with the King of Denmark's galliard, which is, of course, exactly in the middle of the book. There are 21 pieces, and that's number 11, perhaps the crucial turning point in the book, dedicated to his employer, the King of Denmark. And then we go down the social order, from the Earl of Essex to a knight, Sir John Such, and then gentleman down to a pirate, Captain Piper, and ending with two almains. The pavan was a stately dance. It was basically stylized walking. And Arbo describes this in his book of 1588, where kings, princes, and great lords display themselves on some day of solemn festival with their fine mantles and ceremonial robes, the queens, princesses, and great ladies following them with their dresses, the trains of their dresses let down behind them. Thomas Morley in England talks about the construction of pavans. He says it's the next in gravity and goodness unto the fantasy, which is the most important instrumental form, a kind of staid music ordained for grave dancing and most commonly made of three strains or sections, whereof each is played or sung twice. A strain they make to contain 8, 12 or 16 semibreves, and he describes it elsewhere as going by fours, these units of four, which fit exactly the walking steps of the pavan. And we can see in this rather earlier illustration from Germany at the beginning of the century, this idea of the ceremonial dance, a couple dance, the gentleman accompanying and talking to the lady in their fine costume in procession round a great hall. The seven Lachrimae pavans each has its title, and in my mind this depicts a pattern, a shape, which I've put here as a descent and then a rise. Seven, of course, was always a symbolic number in Renaissance theory. There were seven planets in classical astronomy, there were 7 days of the week, there were seven heavens, there were seven colours of the rainbow, seven virtues, seven joys and sorrows of the Virgin Mary, and so on. The trajectory definitely seems to be downwards and then upwards if we follow the names. And if we translate the Latin titles that Dowland gives them, they follow a pattern. First, the old or the ancient tiers, antiquae. Then the new old tiers, the first of the variations created out of the old tiers. Then tiers of groaning. And down to the bottom of the curve, tristes, in the pit of despair, sad and bitter tears. Tristes might also be translated as grave, serious tears. Then we begin perhaps a rise with coacte, a disputed Latin word that's been translated by different musicologists in different ways. Literally enforced tears, and some people have regarded that as perhaps false tears, crocodile tears. But I think the definition is more to do with bringing together, gathering together. A dictionary definition of coacti is from 1587, is assembled, gathered, grown together, compelled, wrought to close or knit together. Something about pulling yourself together. It's the same word as coagulated in modern English. Having pulled yourself together, you begin to love. So we have lover's tears. And finally, back to the level of the ancient tears, are true tears, veri, at the end. Now, this rise, this fall and rise, leads to all sorts of possible interpretations. We don't know what Dowland intended, and modern performers have to come to their own conclusions about what they wish to portray through their interpretation of the seven dances. It may be a religious fall and rise. It's possible that antiquae is God, antiquae novae is man made in God's likeness. He falls from grace, exiled from paradise, and groans and realizes the bitterness of his situation, and then is compelled to seek restitution and reconciliation with God, which he does through the love of God and the love of the divine, reaching a state of reconciliation and salvation. I know this is completely the wrong period of picture, but this image of the expulsion from the Garden of Eden by Masaccio, I think, expresses very well the idea of gementes and tristes. Another possible interpretation is that these are different aspects of melancholy, self-knowledge through experience of misery and introspection, leading to images such as Hilliard's young man, isolated with his black cloak, thinking deeply in his briars of roses. Melancholy was a really important aspect of 16th century philosophy, and Burton's book, The Anatomy of Melancholy, published just after these pieces were published, refers to music as a powerful antidote to the melancholic state of mind. Many men are melancholy by hearing music. Music can make you feel melancholy, but it is a pleasing melancholy that it causeth, and therefore, to such as are discontent, in woe, fear, sorrow, or dejected, it is a more present remedy. It expels cares, alters their grieved minds, and easeth in an instant. So maybe this is the journey that Dowland's portraying through the seven pavans, starting with deep melancholy and working your way through listening to the music and finding it eased as it reaches the stasis of true tears at the end. Dowland, we know, associated himself with melancholy. He signs himself here, Joe Dolandi de Lachrimae, Dowland of the Lachrimae. And Henry Peacham in 1612 depicts Dowland as a nightingale sitting on a bare winter branch and says, here Philomel in silence sits alone in depth of winter on the bared briar. In grateful times and worthless age of ours that lets us pine when it hath cropped our flowers. Referring to Dowland being rejected by court and not getting the recognition that Peacham thought he deserved. Certainly Lachrimae became associated with the road to out of melancholy. The Puritan lawyer Prynne, writing the book Histriomastix in 1633, an anti-theatre diatribe, writes, alas, there are but few that find the narrow way, and those few, what are they? Not dancers, but mourners, not laughers, but weepers, whose tune is Lachrimae, whose music sighs for their sin. The song Flow My Tears, which Dowland published in 1600, uses the ancient Lachrimae, and he calls it Lachrimae at the top, sets words to the pavan. The pavan existed as a lute piece back in the 1590s. It's that ancient. And the words are set here in the treble part and also on the right-hand side in the opposite alignment for a bass voice with the lute part. Flow my tears, fall from your springs, exiled forever, let me mourn where night's black bird her sad infamy sings. There let me live forlorn, revelling in melancholy. And we have this opening little phrase, flow my tears, a long note as the tear wells up and then trickles down the cheek, and then a huge leap up, fall from your springs, and so on. And we can hear this, the beginning of this, sung by Caroline Trevor, accompanied by Jacob Herringman on lute and Sarah Grosser playing the bass part. The words don't fit terribly well, and it works very well as a bass viol part. The first dance uses exactly the same melody. In the bottom left-hand corner, you see the cantus, the top part, with exactly that tune. And then we move round the table book format. This is so that performers can sit with the book in the middle of the table, sitting round different sides of it, moving clockwise from the cantus. We have the bassus part. The bass viol takes up quite a lot of room, so he gets an end to himself. The two lower middle parts on the opposite side, facing upside down as we look at it, then round the corner to the lute tablature for the lute part. The lute also takes up a fair amount of room with its neck sticking out horizontally, and then ending up with the alto part, the second part down next to the cantus part. Sitting round a table to play and perform was often used. We have the sole illustration of a viol consort from Elizabethan England in a memorial portrait for Sir Henry Unton. And you can see here, although they're not playing from a table book, they've got separate little part books, the five viols sitting round a table facing each other in a very typical pose. After the galliard, after the pavans, was normally set a galliard. Now, Dowland doesn't put galliards between his Lachrimae pavans, which is important. They're a unit, and I think they are best heard as a sequence of seven dances. But he lightens the collection with galliards later on. And the galliard, as I said earlier, was a male showing off dance. We see two illustrations here of young men learning some of the steps from Il Ballerino. One of the things was to kick your leg as high as you could, and you hung a tassel from the ceiling and practiced by kicking the tassel. The Dowland galliards that are included in this evening's concert include not only the King of Denmark's galliard, which is a battle piece, it has all sorts of associations with trumpets and drums, but also other pieces which relate to songs. Many of the galliards in this collection had already been published as songs. And the Earl of Essex's galliard is in fact a version of Can You Excuse My Wrongs, which had been published in the first book of Aeirs. It's interesting in its final section, it includes a popular melody, Will You Go Walk the Wood So Wild? And this is thought to possibly to be a reference to the fact that the Earl of Essex used to go and live in his estate at Wanstead in the forest of Epping outside London whenever he was exiled from court, as often happened when he fell out with Queen Elizabeth. A third galliard is dedicated to Sir John Such, and that's another song piece. It's My Thoughts Are Winged With Hopes, again from the first book, which Dowland is reusing as dance music in this collection. And the other Dowland dance that we hear this evening is Mr. Buckton's Galliard. Now this is different. It's again based on pre-existing material, but not on one of Dowland's own songs. In fact, it's based on Lassus's song, Suzanne Un Jour, very well known throughout Europe, which tells the story of Susanna and the elders. And it's curious that Dowland would use this as a basis for a galliard, because it's definitely not in three time, the three time steps that you need for a galliard. The song's in two, and I'll just play the opening of this, sung by the Hilliard Ensemble, to give you a sense of the dupal time. And then when you hear the galliard tonight, you'll realise how it's like looking at yourself in a distorting mirror. You know it's Suzanne Un Jour, but it doesn't feel right because it's being converted into three time. Moving to Holborne, his pavans, galliards and almains and other airs, both grave and light, again in five parts for viols, violins or other musical wind instruments, other there meaning or otherwise. If you haven't got viols or violins, then you can play these on cornets and sackbuts or recorders. This is the very first publication in England that mentions viols as the performance medium, which it, for a viol player is really exciting. We know there's music before this that could be played on viols, but this is the first piece to actually collection to specify viols as the composer's preferred medium. Holborne, like Dowland, was a lute player and particularly specialist on the wire-strung instruments, the pandora and the cittern, and many of the dances in this collection exist also as solo instrument pieces. They're dedicated to a former employer, Sir Richard Champernowne Knight, a wealthy landowner in Devon in southwest England. And he says that these dances included in the 1599 book, many of them had been heard by Champernowne in his music at home, but that he's added new music to them. And he says, in this regard, I have bundled them up in a catalogue volume, accompanied with a more liberal and enlarged choice than hath at any time as yet come to your refined ears. And although they are in number many, so are they of nature variable, to please variable natures, a variety of moods and styles, again, serious pavans and light almains and galliards, and it's particularly the galliards that are represented in tonight's concert. Holborne had been associated with the literary circle of the Countess of Pembroke and Sir Philip Sidney, her brother, another member of which was Edmund Spenser, whose Fairy Queen was published in London in 1590. And it may well be that a piece like Holborne's The Fairy Round is part of this Fairy Queen imagery. There are two other galliards characterised by their syncopations and cross rhythms in the different parts. One of the things that galliard composers particularly like to exploit was the hemiola, the distinction between six beats divided up into two lots of three, contrasted with the same six beats divided up into three lots of two. So we get one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, three. And that gives a spring to the step of the galliard. He also includes pavans. In fact, in the organisation of this book is rather different from Dowland's. Instead of putting all the pavans first and then all the galliards, Holborne alternates. He puts them in pairs, so you get a pavan and a galliard in the same key. And there are 26 of these pairs, followed by another set of lighter dances at the end of the book. And one of the pavans in Holborne's collection he calls the Image of Melancholy. And in some ways it is related to the Lachrimae pavans. The reason it's an image of melancholy is that it changes the nature of that opening flow my tears phrase and puts it into a major key instead of a minor one. And it's full of optimistic rising scales towards the end, as though it's turned the whole idea of the falling of tears into an aspirational rising and optimism in the end of the piece. Holborne died in 1602, just a couple of years after his publication, and we don't know what he might have done had he lived longer. His wife wrote a slightly pathetic letter to Sir Robert Cecil. "Most honourable, the care my husband had of your honour's business," this was when he was sent off to the Netherlands carrying messages, "in studying to effect the same, took such a cold that I fear will be his life's loss. And by his death I shall be left a desolate and distressed widow, unable to give him that burial that befitteth a man of his place." Letter written in December 1602, and Holborne died very shortly after that. On a more light note, let's end with a picture of Elizabethan dancing. This is La Volta, a particularly rumbustious form of galliard, and we see here a string band, in this case two violins and cello, accompanying the dancing, giving a sense of the spirit of the dance. So to conclude, I'd like just to suggest that the seven Lachrimae pavans, as well as being put in the context of the livelier dances that we'll hear this evening, do constitute a real high point in English instrumental music, certainly of the 17th century, unlike anything else that was written either in England or on the continent. Almost certainly they should be performed in the sequence as we're going to hear them. And the sustained intensity of this passionate music is like nothing else. Quite what their story is left very much to you as the listener to interpret. Whether it's a religious epic or something to do with melancholy, or simply a transition from darkness to light. I'd like to just leave you with a little anecdote. My group, the Rose Concert of Viols, have played the Lachrimae Pavans on many occasions, and at one concert, a gentleman came up to me at the end and just looked me straight in the eyes and said, "You don't know what you've done." And I looked back and I looked bemused. He said, "That's changed my life." And before I could ask him how or what he meant, he just turned tail and walked away. Now, if seven dances can have that impact on somebody, Dowland has a lot to answer for, doesn't he? Let's hope that this evening my thoughts about this will allow you to make up your own mind about what the story is between the Lachrimae Pavans, and that you enjoy them in the context of the other music. I hope that's been helpful, and thank you for listening.